Welcome inside Don Laughlin's Riverside Resort for the finals of the 2001 Women's U.S. Open Bowling Championship presented by Riverside Resort. Hello, everyone. I'm Jan Schmidt, and I am so excited to be here and so very glad you're with us. You'll be watching history in the making. The field this week bowled for the largest purse ever, and in 90 minutes, someone will walk away with an unprecedented paycheck in women's bowling. Let's not forget the importance of a Women's U.S. Open title. It's very precious. It's a classic. So the ladies surrounded themselves with classics this morning at Don Laughlin's Classic Car Collection. Let's meet them. Qualifying fifth, showing her class and professionalism in a 59 Corvette with 24 karat gold trim, Kim Terrell. In the number four position, working on her first title and working on the engine of a rare 55 Thunderbird, rookie Kelly Kulick. Qualifying third, the 96 U.S. Open champion, a 63 Corvette Stingray, Liz Johnson. In the number two position, looking stunning like the 62 Corvette at her side, Leanne Barrette. And in the top spot, hoping to set the pace today in a 37 Ford Speedster, Wendy Macpherson. Working with me today will be Carolyn Doran Ballard. Carolyn, that purse I talked about, $300,000, $55,000 for first place. What is the thought process going on in these ladies' heads right now?
Well, all the finalists had different and mixed feelings about this year's U.S. Open. Some of the finalists put a lot of pressure on themselves as soon as they walked in the building. They thought about the $300,000. They thought about the $55,000 paycheck. It wasn't until the tournament began that they put one foot in front of the other, took one day at a time, and achieved their goal to make the TV show. The other finalists enjoyed a week off before the Open, came here and acted like it was just another week. It wasn't until the interviews that they realized what a way to end the year with a $55,000 paycheck and a U.S. Open title. It was a 56-game format, very grueling. You have to be mentally tough and physically fit to beat the best women bowlers in the world.
Well, in order to show you the full impact of these matches, we'll attempt to bring them to you without commercial break. And to get you in the psyche of our bowlers and our fans, we brought in a sideline reporter. It's Kathy Doran Lizzie. Kathy?
Well, I'm standing here with the household name Wendy Macpherson, our tournament leader, who won this event back in 1986 for $12,000 as an amateur. 15 years later, she's back on top for $55,000. Wendy, what are your thoughts for today?
Wow, Kathy, I hope I have a great day of bowling. It was so long ago that I won. I can still remember it, though, and I'd like to relive those feelings again.
Well, good luck today. You're a great champion. And coming up next, the road to this championship begins. Stay with us.
The finals of the 2001 Women's U.S. Open Bowling Championship presented by Riverside Resort are being brought to you by the Women's International Bowling Congress, striving for 86 years to identify and fulfill the needs of women bowlers. By Travelodge Hotels, first with families, relax with Travelodge. And by Bowling's Mega Strike Jackpot, awarding thousands of dollars to league bowlers. Is your bowling center participating?
I'm with Liz Johnson, our number three qualifier. Liz, you looked aggressive as ever, and you chose to finish last to put the pressure on yourself. Was that an offensive decision or a defensive decision?
It's mostly offensive. Most of the time, I like to just put the pressure on myself, and that's usually just how I like to finish.
You feel good today?
Yeah, I do.
Good luck.
Thanks.
Back to you, Jan.
Thanks, Kathy, and you heard it. It was an offensive decision. Carolyn, Liz Johnson, I remember being told by the great Fred Borden, one of the great all-time coaches, that Liz had ice water in her veins. I guess that's why she likes to finish last.
Well, not only that, the stats prove it. I mean, 6 years on tour, she's got 10 titles, two which are majors. I mean, she is there when she is needed, so she doesn't mind finishing last.
First look at Kim Terrell, and Kim really, really would like to put a major title to her resume.
Absolutely. Kim hasn't won in a couple of years. Her last title was a doubles title, so she really wants to prove this to herself. She's really worked hard on a game.
Great start with that strike, a little break and carry. Here's Kelly Kulick, a hot, hot rookie. Unbelievable nine telecasts this season in a rookie year that ties the record of Cara Honeychurch's set last year in a rookie season.
Yeah. Trips out the little 4-9 there. Start her off, loosen her up a little bit.
Okay, Liz Johnson, they're going last. 27 years old, this lady, no stranger to U.S. Open victory.
won this event back in 1996.
As a rookie, can't get any better than that. Everyone's starting with the straight. When you can win the U.S. Open as an amateur, I mean, as a rookie, that pretty much will say something about your talent.
211 average, pretty high average. U.S. Open, typically a low-scoring tournament. The field average, pretty low, but these five ladies obviously found a way to conquer the conditions.
Absolutely. They got a little tougher as the week went on. And really, the girls that made the telecast today basically stayed within the top six throughout the week.
Well, Kelly Kulick may be the exception. She started low the first round, like 39th position, and then continued up throughout the week to make the show.
Right, but once she approached that top five, she never fell out of the top five.
Oh,
great shot, pin going in front of the 10 pin, leaving it standing.
Wow, and she almost had a 7-10 for a minute. I know you're familiar with those on TV, Carolyn.
Yeah, once in a while.
210 average for Liz Johnson.
Liz also playing a little further right than the other two ladies. Great shot by Liz, right up the lane. Liz said that was her advantage this week. As the lanes got tougher, she can move further right into her comfort zone.
You saw that Liz averaged lower than the fifth place competitor, but that's because Liz won 18 matches, grabbed those 30 bonus pins for 18 matches. And we've been talking about this field, 132 bowlers. There's that average I talked about, 193 to cash.
Been low all year. That's pretty average to what it's been. And to make match play, 202, not much higher. That's all spares right there, a few doubles and triples.
Kim Terrell now tied with Liz Johnson for the lead. Kelly Kulick trailing by 20 pins. And they are continuing to strike. Okay, we're talking about this huge purse. Let me do it right now. There's $50,000. Bonus on the line from Travelodge if anyone shoots a 300 game here in this telecast.
What a way to end the year. A 300 plus the 55. My goodness, somebody's taking everybody out to dinner.
No, I'll be getting that tennis bracelet I want, I think, from whoever wins.
You bet.
There's the purse we were talking about. 50,000, 55,000, excuse me, on top. Not too bad down the line from there, Carolyn.
Not at all. Fifth place, 13,000. You can't ask for a better week than that.
Roll. Get up.
Coming up light, just barely leaving a two pin.
Seems like Liz missed a little bit right when she let that go. Basically, when you missed a little right this week, you had a little bit of hang to the right. Ball didn't recover as hard. Looks like she might have lost that a little bit. Changes ball to shoot at her spare. Ball that goes real straight.
With LSU's upset of Tennessee yesterday, the College Bowl picture blew wide open. Find out tonight at 6 p.m. where your favorite team will end up with the College Game Day Bowl Selection Show. Reese Davis, Rod Gilmore, and Mark May break down all the bowl matchups for you tonight at 6. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. Kim Terrell wiping her ball. Now, Carolyn, a lot of the athletes do that. They're wiping conditioner off their ball or trying to.
There's a little oil on the ball. They want a clean surface for that shot, so they wipe it off with the towel.
Seems to be a little distraction going. Some spectators moving in and out. We have a large crowd here today. And a spectator came in and moved way down the lane. So this is something the ladies a little unaccustomed to. We usually don't have them that far down the lane.
Yes, and Kim Terrell has really worked on her mental game, so it's better that she walked off the approach and comes back with a great shot.
That's a huge key and a hard thing to learn, to not let it upset you. You step off sometimes, but you still let it eat at you and get back up, and you're irritated and can't make a shot.
Absolutely, you kind of just have to regroup and start over.
Kelly Kulick talking to herself on the approach.
Come on, ball. Carry. Yes!
Good shot by Kelly. Kelly said last night when we were talking to her, she's going to take a little walk, have a new perspective on this game today. You know, it's only one shot that's cost her in her previous telecasts.
And it's always been the ninth frame for the most part, so it'll be interesting when we get to that frame what'll happen.
Hold.
Here Liz yelling, hold. She got that one left a little bit.
And in held. So right now it appears we'll have some scores, although typically throughout the week the lanes transitioned very quickly and your scoring potential changed. Kim Terrell still looking to shoot that 300 game. Kelly Kulick can shoot 280, and Liz Johnson could go off the sheet. That's if they strike out for 270. Oh, mixing them up there.
Don't forget, Kim Terrell did shoot 299, I believe it is, in the doubles, the Baker in her last title.
She did.
She knows what it's like to throw strikes on TV.
That was with Linda Barnes. Best finish for Kelly Kulick in a U.S. Open, second runner-up last year to Tennille Grijalva. Kelly really struggled getting lined up. Much better performance this year.
Absolutely. She's got a year under her belt, a little more mentally focused on what she needs to do. Gets this one down the lane to the right, threw it great, ring and 10. She was happy with that shot, too. She was talking to it down the lane.
Oh, that's got to roll.
Liz, that has to roll. I take it that was a bad shot.
Yeah, please roll, ball.
Yeah, that was the begging shot. It's all right, spareable. Kelly changing balls to shoot at her 10 pin.
Slide.
And it did.
Delta had to help that one. I wasn't sure it was going to get there. Liz attempting to cover the spare. No problem. We told you we'd get into the psyche of the bowlers and their fans. Well, Kathy Doran Lizzie is standing by with Kim Terrell's mother.
I'm here with Joyce and Owens Terrell, Kim Terrell's parents. Nervous? I see your palms sweating all the way from across the room. You thought you'd never see her bowl for 55,000, I bet, huh?
Not right now. I thought it would have been a while.
Owens, you started her bowling. How do you feel?
Well, I gave her the basics when she was about 8 years old, but I can't take credit for the finished product.
Well, you did a wonderful job. Back to you, Jan, Carolyn.
Thanks, Kathy, and I want to know which one of them is taking credit for this 7-10. It was a great shot. bad break, and how unfortunate. She's talking to her parents, and look what happens.
Push. Yes!
Oh, another trip four. Asking it to push. Push just enough, trip the four pin, gets the break. Here's Kim's shot. Pins just leave the deck. 7-10 standing, bad break.
Unfortunate break for Kim Terrell, and I'm sure her parents are a lot more nervous right now. As she just leads by 7 pins, Kelly Kulick and Liz Johnson trail by 7. Kelly and Liz both have an opportunity to shoot 259. Kim Terrell could shoot 266. That's if they take it off the sheet. And again, Liz calling for the ball to roll up. It doesn't. 2-8-10, and this one is a tough conversion.
You may be seeing a little bit of transition on the lane. Kim is a little further right also than Kelly, not as far right as Liz. She just 7-10 on that lane. Liz 2-8-10. We might be seeing a little bit of a change.
Well, she's going to try and probably take the wood and hope something bounces out, and it didn't. The Seattle Seahawks look to keep their playoff hopes alive as they face division rivals the Denver Broncos. That's tonight, Sunday, in Sunday Night Football. Coverage begins at 7:30 p.m. with NFL Primetime presented by Miller Lite. And then Mike Patrick, Paul McGuire, and Joe Theismann bring you this tough AFC West matchup. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. Look at the score right now. Kim Terrell still in the lead by 7 pins. Liz Johnson, though, trailing because of that open frame.
Kim did while they were warming up, does have the right lane just a little bit tighter, and she did choose to use two different balls. Good comeback shot. She's using two different balls on that lane. The left lane definitely hooks a little bit more for her. Like I said, she has the right lane tighter, so we may be seeing a little bit of carry down.
And Carolyn, you saw that throughout the week, didn't you? One lane of the pair tighter than the other lane of the pair.
Very drastically. That's why going pair to pair, it was very crucial for you to make a good shot on your first shot, because the read of the lane was very hard.
roll. 2.5 average on this pair for Kelly Kulick throughout the week. She's looking to better that right now. Very close to that pace, though. Liz Johnson now up in the seventh frame, attempting to recover from that split in the sixth.
There you go. Makes a good shot, just like Kim did.
Talking about the transition, Carolyn, here's what they're bowling on.
We bowled on a 38-foot pattern this week with 28.465 milliliters of oil. It's a very high volume of oil, more oil in the front part of the lane. It's tapered down towards the middle part of the lane. This is what creates the hook in the middle part of the lane and a little bit of the carry down on the outside part of the lane. We had a forward and reverse oil. And what that did was, because of the three squads and the amount of bowlers, we needed a little more volume on the lane.
.269 game this week for Kelly Kulick, and that low game of 151. As I said, she struggled in the beginning of the tournament.
Oh, can't
Kelly leaving a 10 pin, and Kathy Doran Lizzie is down on the floor with Kim Terrell.
Kim Terrell, you just made 8 quality shots, 1 bad break. What's your focus?
Well, I'm just trying to take it kind of one frame at a time, not to get too caught up in what Kelly and I are doing, and just make good shots.
Great job. Jan?
Thanks, Kathy. Well, it's a good thing that she wasn't watching there, seeing Liz Johnson get that messenger go across, knock out the 10 pin.
Getting a great break. And as you can see, Liz's ball's going down on the right lane just a little bit longer than on the left lane. Depending on who wins this match, we may see a little bit of a move on that right lane.
So Kim Terrell in the lead, even though she had that 7-10, she now leads by 28 pins because that's the only frame she didn't strike so far this match.
And like she said, she's just been focusing on one shot at a time. This is where she really worked mentally. Try not to get ahead of herself, because when she gets ahead of herself, she loses what she's supposed to be doing.
That's where Kim has typically been better in a team or double H environment, because she had the assistance of a partner. Either they relied on her or she relied on them. Now she's on her own, and she's worked very hard mentally, and you can see the progress.
Absolutely.
Okay, Kelly Kulick, U.S. Open, rookie season.
Pressure's kind of on Kelly, really. She's got a lot to really gain here today by winning.
Well, one of her goals, obviously, was to win a title. Hasn't done that yet, but only wanted to make 5 shows. She's made 9.
Absolutely, and she's making some really, really good shots. And this is typical of Kelly, though. Her first match, she'll come out very aggressive. She marked in the 9th frame. Things could be changing.
Liz Johnson in the 9th frame. Big shot, really had to have that one. Liz Johnson could take it off the sheet for 234. Kelly Kulick could take it out for 238. That means Kim Terrell really just needs a mark here to advance. Going high, fortunate to leave just a 3-6.
It looked like she lost that one a little bit, missed way inside, ball hooked. Like I was explaining with the lane condition, once you miss in, there is no hold, and the ball goes right through the middle of the pins.
Kelly Kulick, she'll still step up and try to strike out. You never know. Beautiful shot. Come on,
I can still do this. Very animated, very determined lady out there.
Meanwhile, Kim Terrell needs to get the ball, hopefully to cover both of these pins, the 3 and the 6.
Get 2.
Ooh, she was begging on that one, and it looked like it might slide by.
So she'll need about 5 pins on this shot. She'll need 5 pins on this shot to shut out Kelly Kulick. That's assuming Kelly strikes. And she does.
She pulled a great game. This was one of the typical Kelly games. She came out very aggressive, and she stayed aggressive throughout the whole match, making good quality shots in the 9th and 10th frame.
Five pins, you want to keep it in the middle of the lane. Pretty safe if you hit the head pin, you should get at least five.
You would hope so. Close the rack, that's plenty.
Double that, so Kim Terrell will advance. But first, when we come back, I'll take you on a tour. R&R poolside was great, and I hope you're enjoying some R&R TV side. Right now, Kathy will get the inside scoop from Kim Terrell. Kathy?
Well, I'm standing with Kim Terrell, victorious in match number one, 244. Kim, 10 great quality shots, one bad break, one high shot. Your focus has to be high. You've worked hard mentally. How are you feeling going into the semifinal match?
Well, I'm pretty comfortable. I'm really just trying to stay within my own game and really not worry about what my opponent's doing, so I feel pretty good about the next match.
You're thinking about the money?
No.
Well, when we return, Jan Schmidt spoke to the main man whose dream became the town where the PWBA made history. Stay with us.
Welcome back to the 2001 Women's U.S. Open Bowling Championship presented by Riverside Resort. We're here in the Bowling Center at Riverside Resort. Just completed the first match. And Kim Terrell, in the 6th frame, had a disastrous break.
This is the lane she's playing a little bit tighter. Looks like a great shot. Just leaves a blower 7-10.
She came back well, though. Bounced right back.
Absolutely, great shot. Boosts the confidence a little.
Needed this spare to win.
Close, but makes it.
Final score in match one, Kim Terrell 244 to Kulick's 238 and Johnson's 212. So it will be Kim Terrell taking on her good friend Leanne Boomer Barrette. Right.
Down to Kathy to find out what Leanne's strategy is.
I'm with our number two qualifier, Leanne Barrette, another familiar face out here on the PWBA Tour. Leanne, all those titles, only one major under your belt. You finished second in this tournament back in 1991, and you have to bowl your tour best friend, Kim. How are you going to handle that?
Well, this is what we wanted. We both wanted to be here, and hopefully we'll have a good match, and one of us will be bowling for the title, so it'll be good.
Free dinner either way.
Either way.
Back to you, Jan.
Hey, thanks, Kathy. Hey, free dinner. I don't think she meant us. I think she meant both of them, huh? Kim and Leanne. But hey, maybe we'll join them. We're ready for the semifinal match here, and Kim Terrell will be first up. Taking a little time here to get on the lanes after that commercial break. She defeated Kulick and Johnson, as we said, in that first match, 244 to 238 and 212.
Kim is 3-1 against Leanne, so she has. She has the upper hand when they've met on TV. First shot by Kim. Kim's really throwing the ball well. She's really worked on her physical game along with her mental game. Try to stay behind the ball a little more, not be so much on the side of it. Let the ball roll a little more.
Leanne Barrette, 34 years old, 15 years on tour, 23 titles, and Carolyn, only one of those titles is a major.
Unbelievable. She's also got 89 TV appearances. That's amazing.
Nice shot to Leanne. Let's talk about the friendship issue for just a moment, Carolyn. You have to bowl against friends. You also have to bowl against your sister. Does that affect your competitive outlook when you're down there?
You know, I'm sure it does to just very little to a certain extent, but you really have to focus in on what you're doing. And one of the ways to do that is when you are bowling on TV, maybe not watching what your opponent's doing. It kind of takes away, you know, then you're forgetting who you're really bowling against. But I'm sure it is a little hard, but, you know, the more you're there, you kind of get used to it.
Well, I guess the best thing for you is shoot a great game. That was a pretty good shot.
It's a lot easier when you're bowling on TV and you know you made the best shot you can, you just didn't get the breaks. It's a little easier to handle. Good shot by Leanne, leaves the ring in 10. Leanne basically playing the same line, close to what Kelly Kulick was doing in the first game.
Right, you talked about a variety of styles. She covers up that spare. So Kelly and Leanne, similar.
Very similar. Leanne's a little more on the side of the ball. Kelly's a little bit more behind the ball and comes around it. She's a little more of a finesse player, and that's what allows her to open up the lane the way she does.
What about Kim Terrell?
Kim Terrell's a little, I call her an in-betweener. She's not really, really straight like a Liz Johnson. Gets a little more roll in the front part of the lane, which allows her to open up the heads just a little bit and get a little different angle on the back end.
Obviously didn't open up the heads enough right there.
Missed a little left on that right lane. Now, don't forget, this is the lane that Kim had tighter. She's using a stronger ball with a stronger pin placement with the hole. Now, the shot in the 10 frame, same thing here. Misses a little left. There's no hold in the middle part of the lane. Ball goes right to the Brooklyn.
Cover up the spare, though, and that's the thing to do, especially in the U.S. Open. Those scores particularly high for a U.S. Open first match. Right now, all even. Strike, spare, or piece.
Might be seeing a little bit of a transition on the right lane. I said, you know, we'd see who made, you know, the next match, see if there's going to be a move on the lanes. Let's see if Kim, what Kim does when she gets up on that right lane. She might even move a little left, try to get the ball a little right.
Max score right now, 280 for both ladies.
Hit. Very good shot. She said it when she let it go. Good shot. Both ladies here, very much field players. Kim talks about her feel all the time. Leanne, one of the issues she had to combat this week, her nerves, which when she is trying to get over the nerves, she loses her feel a little bit.
Light gets the mixer. Big event, a lot of money on the line. The other finishers for this event, sixth place, just missing out, Jennifer Swanson. BWAA Bowler of the Month for October, Michelle Feldman finished up in eighth, a pair of Doran sisters, seventh and ninth.
Kim Adler in 12th, our 1999 U.S. Open champion, and our last year's champion, Tamila Grijalva, in 15th.
Interesting note, Leanne Barrette, it's her fifth U.S. Open show. She has a second, third, fourth, and fifth place finish.
It's almost like it's meant to be. Bad shot for Leanne. You heard it out of her mouth. That needs to hook. Got it way right down the lane. And that's where you get, when we're talked about the lane condition, you get that little bit of hold, little bit of hang to the right. She gets it too far right. Ball never recovers.
That's what we're talking about, the accuracy required to play on many of the conditions that these ladies bowl on. Second, you saw there was that second place in 91. That was to Anne-Marie Dugan. Who wishes she were bowling her right now?
Absolutely.
But recovered with the spare, no problem.
Okay, the first shot on this, let's see, start on the left lane. Now, Kim went high twice on this lane and once light. So let's see what she does on this shot. Good shot. Looks like
big strike for Kim Terrell. The top PGA, senior PGA, and LPGA members compete as teams at the Hyundai Team Matches this afternoon at 4 p.m. That's on ABC. That's 4 p.m. Eastern. You won't want to miss it. And I hope you stay with us continuing this U.S. Open action. We are in the semifinal match. I'm Jan Schmidt along with Carolyn Doran Ballard. Kim Terrell now up in the fifth frame, working on a double. She did strike on that lane, Carolyn. So we didn't get to talk about that. Did she make a change?
Seems like she might have moved a little bit left, got that ball a little bit further right down the lane than she did. Didn't miss left, and she got the reaction she needed.
So Leanne Barrette now finds herself in a position of needing to strike. She trails by 20 pins. She said her strength was she got off to a good start this week, but her nerves were a factor.
That one works back, definitely. Yes, like I said, Leanne's a field player, so when she's battling her nerves, she loses her feeling. It takes her a little while to get it back. So she was very glad that she got off to a strong start, because when she did battle that problem, it wasn't as drastic.
There you see Leanne Barrette. No nerves on that game. Well, maybe on the last ball. 299. Tammy Turner with a 289. Couple high games. Hey, there's our sideline reporter. 279. Kathy Doran Lizzie. Lisa Bishop and Dee Dee Davidson also with some 279s, but no 300s yet. We're hoping for one tonight, so they get a $50,000 bonus from Travelodge. Right now, it would have to come in the championship match, because the max score for Kim Terrell is 280, and for Liam, 260.
Leanne putting together a double.
Kim has 7 titles to her credit, but no majors. This is her first U.S. Open show.
Good shot.
Kim makes it 4 in a row, and sideline reporter Kathy Doran Lizzie is down there with a special guest.
I'm with one of the pioneers in women's professional bowling, Jeanette Robinson, and at 73 years young, she has competed in every U.S. Open since the very beginning, this year being her 38th U.S. Open. Jeanette, tell us the changes you've seen over the years.
Well, I think right now what we're seeing would bring tears to anyone's eyes. It's just terrific. The girls work so hard. I know how dedicated they are because I'm out here occasionally. And I'm just so very proud of them. You know, I bowled in the Marion Ladwig, Laverne Carter, in that era, and saw the winning going on. But right now, I see in the tour something that is wonderful for bowling. I work for Coast Properties, the Orleans, and of course they've just stepped right up into sponsorship of all the pro tournaments, men and women alike. And they wouldn't do it unless it was warranted.
Well, thank you very much for joining us, Jeanette. Back to you, Jan.
Thanks, Kathy, and holy cow, 38 U.S. Opens.
Unbelievable. She's a credit to our sport, and besides that, one of the nicest ladies I've ever met.
She definitely is. She has been one that fought long and hard to get us to where we are today.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jeanette.
Leanne Barrette liked this pair throughout the week with a 225 average on it. It's a trip the two, and it's not going to happen.
Looked like a pretty good shot when she let it go. Just didn't quite make the turn. Left the two pin. Looked like a pretty good shot. She might have thrown it just a little bit harder than she had been. Leaves the wiggling two pin. One thing Leanne said really helped her with her nerves is she didn't watch the scoreboard this week. Every now and then she kind of peeks over to see how the scores are going, and this week she never looked.
That's Barron. We're talking about Jeanette fighting. Well, there was a lot involved in getting to this point in this U.S. Open, and one of the ladies who was a big part of it was Billie Jean King, a famous tennis star who had the Battle of the Sexes, beat Bobby Riggs, and she was very active in working with the women and having them stick together, and then we all worked with BPA and wound up with this tremendous event.
The Women's Sports Foundation was very instrumental, and they were very supportive of us, and they're supportive of women athletes all over the world. And we really thank Billie Jean King and all her staff and the Women's Sports Foundation, everyone involved. Donna, helping us out.
Exactly. Donna Lopiano, the executive director, came out with the players. Fantastic.
Oh,
big break. And Billie Jean King personally came here on Sunday to the event.
This is the lane that's hooking more for everybody. Break sharply. Pin comes around on the deck. Taps out that 9. What a great break. I'm happy, Leanne says.
And now she says,
I'm not looking.
Let me just remember that break and
that's right.
Nothing else.
Another good shot by Kim. actually seems like she got that one in maybe just a little bit left of where she had been playing, and it held, but she made the move left. She's made some good shots on that lane.
So I wonder how many of these women feel, I know I do, and I hope you do, that we're also being a part of future of women's sports here.
Oh, absolutely. I hope that one day, you know, when I have a child, and if it's a girl, I want to know that I did everything possible for her to be able to make the money that she deserves and get the respect she deserves. She went high on that lane last frame, and she had been hitting the left lane. So the left lane now might be changing, and it's time for her to make an adjustment on that left lane. That was the lane that was hooking for everyone in the first match, and now probably is breaking down a little more, bit more in the second match. Goes a little high, leaves the six pin.
She'll change balls to try to cover that up. This match very close right now. All even, both players could strike out for 239. If they go off the sheet, we could have a tie. Wow. Best friends, let's tie in the semifinal match of the U.S. Open.
We don't want this match to end.
Look. Well, right now that took away some of the tie potential, but she was on a strike, so won't lose the pin count.
Like she's throwing a little bit harder, and as you throw it a little bit harder and you throw it through your break point, it doesn't recover as hard as it would if it rolls a little more. And don't forget that right lane was the one that everybody said was tighter no matter what angle you were playing. Liz was playing up the lane, it was tighter. Leanne's going around him, it seems a little tighter.
Covers it up, so she will trail by 20 pins. Best Leanne Barrette could do would be 219 here if she strikes out in the 10th frame.
One of the things Leanne did discuss all week, I bowled with her in the one qualifying round, was her speed control was very crucial. Because of her rotation, her side rotation, when she threw it through her break point, threw it a little bit hard, she said, my ball would never pick up a roll in the right part of the lane. So it was very crucial for her to keep her speed control the same during the week.
Well, right now she needs three strikes to force Kim Terrell to mark in the 10th frame. Go high. And it did. You're right, Leanne Barrette. It did go high. Maybe compensating off that last shot.
Could be. You know, you miss right on one lane. Of course, the next thought process could be, well, don't miss right. May not recover. Goes through the nose. This lane could be breaking down. We may see some moves on this left lane.
So Kim Terrell will just need minimal pin count if Leanne spares and strikes. We'll just have to step up and throw five on her first shot to close this out. So another show and no major win for Leanne Barrette, but she still has one.
She won that
Queens event a couple years ago.
And she got to second place. She said, hey, third place check is great. She can use some of that money to put away for a rainy day. Gonna go home, do some therapy on her hip. Make sure she comes back better than ever next year.
With that strike, it's a 207 for Leanne Barrette. Kim Terrell will need five on her first shot in order to not have to throw another ball and win this match. Of course, if she would get less than five, she would take her next shot. She will still take it, but she would need her next shot if she gets less than five.
Correct.
Eight is enough, or nine is enough, whatever you prefer. So a nice showing for both of these ladies. Leanne Barrette said she could rest on that third place check. As you mentioned, Carolyn, it's actually about what you'd normally win in any other major, so she was happy with that. Kim Terrell hangs on to get her shot at a U.S. Open title. When we come back, the rest of the tour and a farewell to a special lady. When you talk about the PWBA this year, there are many stories that come to the forefront. First and foremost, the year of Carolyn Dorn Ballard. She started her season by winning the prestigious WIBC Queens. And went on to cash in every event, finishing no lower than 14th throughout 2001.
Well, I wanted to make some more shows than I did last year. I felt like I let a couple shows slip by me. Put a little bit too much pressure on myself, so over the break I worked on changing my way of thinking when I came into a tournament, and I was a little more mentally focused and fresh, and it worked.
Well, I'd say it worked. With 7 titles this year, she tied the professional women's record for wins in a season held by Hall of Famer Patty Costello since 1976. And her astonishing 18 TV appearances set a new mark that may never be broken. It truly was an extraordinary year.
I can't really put into words what I feel right now. I mean, I've over accomplished what I set out to do. A year like this is just phenomenal, and I think it's something that you think could possibly happen, but in the back of your mind you're saying 18 finals out of, you know, so many tournaments. So really, I look back at this year, and it's a wonderful year for my career, and it's something I will remember.
If not for Carolyn's incredible season, we might all be talking about Liz Johnson. Going into 2001, she had 6 titles, one of which was a major, the 1996 United States Open. This year, she added 4 more titles to her resume, including another major, the Hammer Players Championship. But perhaps the highlight of her season came in tandem with her victory at the Storm Challenge, as Liz achieved perfection in the final match, bringing much-needed smiles to the fans and athletes. While collecting the Travelodge Hotel's $50,000 bonus.
It was a big confidence booster because, well, the $50,000, you know, it was a financial a great bonus for me, so I can just go out and have fun at the game and just go out and have fun bowling. And I think that's why I'm doing so well this year, is I'm able to have a lot more fun out here.
The thunder from down under and last year's rookie of the year, Cara Honeychurch, clearly dispelled the sophomore jinx theory as she reached the match play finals in all but 2 events, appeared on a remarkable 14 telecast, and captured 4 titles with shots just like this.
Yeah, the sophomore jinx is not something that's probably as commonly referred to in Australia as perhaps what it is in the US, so it wasn't something that was really, you know, playing on my mind coming over here for this year. Just tried to take it one tournament at a time and come over here as best prepared, physically, mentally, and you know, bowling as well as I possibly could, and thankfully you know, I've able to have a reasonably good year, so it's been great.
While the sport condition left some athletes scratching their heads, both Leanne Barrette and Michelle Feldman conquered it twice, bringing Boomer Barrett's career title count to 23. And Twister sister Feldman's to 8. Other PWBA veterans stepped up to the challenge, like Dee Dee Davidson, who battled a roller coaster season to win her 8th pro title at the Las Cruces, New Mexico Open. And though Wendy Macpherson's season paled in comparison to her torrid bowler of the year pace the past 4 out of 5 years, she still compiled some pretty impressive stats, winning career title number 19 while appearing on 10 telecasts. Plus, Tish Johnson amassed several career highlights, including becoming the PWBA's 3rd millionaire, breaking the record for consecutive events bowled and being elected to the WIBC Hall of Fame, making this one of her most memorable seasons.
You know what? I think this year has been the best, even though I haven't made a lot of money. I was the Iron Woman. I was inducted into the Hall of Fame. I broke the $1 million all in 1 year. I mean, what more can you ask for? I'm going to give it one more year and give it everything I got. And after that, we'll see what happens.
We expect all these things out of veterans, but rookies are supposed to lack experience, be a little rough around the edges. No one told that to Kelly Kulick. She showed us what college bowling and Team USA experience can mean as she displayed the polish and talent of a 10-year veteran in her rookie season, making 9 telecasts and finishing second in the WIBC Queens.
And for my first year out of 24 events, including the Open, my goal was to make at least 5 shows and win 2 titles. I thought that was a pretty good ratio. And so right now I've exceeded the one goal where I've made 8 shows now, including the shootout would be 9. But I haven't won yet. So on one end of the scale, I've done great by exceeding the one and making 8 shows and hopefully getting there more often, I'll start to win. But I'm still disappointed that I have yet to win. Hopefully tomorrow and in the future, especially with the US Open left, that I'll exceed that goal by at least winning one event my year.
So the PWBA has just about completed yet another season, bringing you the best in professional women's bowling. We've attempted to show the accuracy and true skills of these elite female athletes by introducing sport bowling. And we're ending our season today with a triumph for women's sports. A $300,000 purse in the 2001 Women's U.S. Open Bowling Championship presented by Riverside Resort. We thank all of you who watched us on ESPN or joined us at a tournament site. The miles we have traveled and the visits to cities, both old and new, have been more enjoyable because of our fans. 228 to Leanne Barrett's 207. Our athletes are finishing warm-up, so let's send you back to Fountain Valley and Jim Kelly for a recap of the men's action. Jim?
Thank you, Jan. Thank you, Carolyn. This is the kind of action we saw here at the Fountain Bowl, and Randy Peterson, we watched it all. How was Mika able to maintain that kind of consistency, all right, in the championship match?
That's a good question. That was actually what I was going to ask Mika. Mika, you were so focused. You came right out, started with a double, left that, you know, you made the 8 spare, and then you just started flushing every shot. How were you able to stay so focused?
That's a good question. I work really hard to stay focused, and only once after the commercial break, I missed a little bit my own. But everything else, I just do what I like to do.
You talked last night at length about working on your concentration and staying focused. What were you able to apply in the championship match?
I just try to concentrate how I exhale, outhale, stuff like that, and that's the way I had the whole week. So.
Do you feel like you can exhale now?
Feels a little bit better now.
You've won in 10 different countries. You've bowled 300 games in 5 different countries, but your 2 victories here have both been majors. Is this one more special?
Yeah, you know, I'm Major Mika.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Big finish for the big Finn, right?
Thank you, thank you.
Congratulations. There is our champion, but we've still got more bowling here on ESPN. Let's go back to Laughlin, Nevada now, and the finals in the U.S. Women's Bowling.
Thanks, Jim. We're finally ready. Coming up next, Kim Terrell and Wendy Macpherson lay it all on the line for a $55,000 payday. Don't go away. Are ready for the championship match of the 2001 Women's U.S. Open Bowling Championship presented by Riverside Resort. $55,000 on the line. I'm on the edge of my seat. I hope you are at home, and I hope everyone's enjoying the 3 hours of live bowling coverage.
Kim's stats on lane 27 and 28. One more strike on 28, which was the tighter lane. It's all right, coming back out of commercial, you might be a little nervous, your thought process, got to get back into the groove. This is spareable.
Okay, so everyone understands this match, actually a $25,000 difference. $55,000 for first, $30,000 for second, so every shot they make is a $25,000 shot.
Absolutely, if that's the way you want to think about it, yes it is.
Well, I can think about it because I'm not throwing the ball, so I'll think about it that way.
We can think about that. They I'm sure somewhere in the back of their mind they're trying to think of other things. Great shot.
What a way to start the championship match.
Throws her spare ball straight at the 1-2, hits it on the left, takes out the 10. She's liking that. She's probably also thinking 9 more frames.
Okay, one out of the way and it's clean. Wendy Macpherson, bowler of the year the past 4 out of 5 years. Lady to my right has been runner-up many of those years. Wendy wanting to finish big, only one title this year. But 10th in the past, actually a very good season, just not as good as hers had been. And she's glad to be top seed, yeah.
Absolutely, boy. 14 times the top seed is won. Not only that, Wendy's no stranger to that spot. I mean, she's a great champion. You don't win 19 titles and those many majors without being a great champion.
Over 63% of the victories have gone to the top seed, and it's usually below 50%. So an interesting year on the PWBA Tour.
Also, Wendy holds the most TV career appearances at 94, and we thought Leanne was a lot at 89. Wow. Early double for Wendy, 2 great shots. Wendy looks like she's playing the lanes basically how she played them all week, pretty straight, not trying to loop it too much, because Wendy does get it out onto the lane, so she's got to make sure her ball gets into a roll.
Played a pretty direct line. Kim Terrell defeated Wendy Macpherson throughout the week, but today is a different story. A lot of money, a lot of prestige on the line.
And Wendy and Kim have met twice on TV, and Wendy has won both times.
Let's put this in a little perspective. Carolyn, 9 countries represented this week, 37 states represented, including some of these bowlers. Anne-Marie Dugan, the 91 U.S. Open champ. Kathy Tribby, she looked great this week. We're going to see her in a final soon. And hey, welcome back, Nikki G. Julius.
In 22nd, we have Maxine Nabel, one of our international players who came out full-time from Australia. And in 24th, we have Tammy Turner back, our 1994 rookie there. Glad to see she's back into the swing of things.
So 37 states, 9 countries, a great, great field here. And it's narrowed down to these 2 bowlers. And again, on lane 27.
Now, the last few shots Kim threw on lane 27, she went high. I noticed while they were taking their practice shots, it did look like she moved a little left. She's getting the ball right, but she's hitting that hang, and the ball is not coming back. She has to make sure she gets the ball into a roll so her ball reads the lane. Throws her spare ball. Good pickup.
Wendy stepping up, working on a double. Wendy told us she never thought that we would bowl for $55,000.
She was, when the whole situation occurred back in July and August, and Wendy was in the midst of it with all of us, she said, it's going to work out, it's going to work out, it's all going to come around. And here we are, and here she is in the championship match.
It worked out way better than anyone anticipated.
Absolutely, and I appreciate everyone's support, and I'm glad we all worked things out and worked together.
Right now, Wendy, is still looking for another $50,000 for that bonus, but not to be. A solid 8, great shot.
Wendy actually a little more behind it than she used to be. She used to be a little more on the side of the ball, trying to get a little more rotation in the front part of the lane. Great shot.
Maybe she wants to go back on the side a little more.
She really worked on that too, especially down at the Kegel Training Center, really trying to stay behind it so she got a little more roll in the front part of the lane.
And you could see it. Great shot there. Camera angle. I want to take a minute and thank, the staff here has been phenomenal. The staff at Riverside, everything you asked for, they did. Also, the Colorado River Women's Bowling Association on hand all week. And Don Laughlin came in for the telecast. That's the man we've been talking about. You saw him on the interview.
Give him a big thanks.
Owner here at Riverside, he said, hey, I'll bring the ladies in. How about we do it? How about Riverside Resort? So fantastic.
We really, really do appreciate it.
Oh, my.
4 really good shots by Wendy. ring and ten pin? Good shot. Ball's right on line. Leave the ring and ten. It's actually still moving.
Wendy's actually been sick the last couple of days and actually fared very well for being as sick as she was.
Yes, actually, she said it kind of calmed her down and it allowed her to take her time. She was a little more slow. She took her time and really she didn't feel rushed at all this week and she felt very comfortable. When the lanes get a little, as they say, wet, dry, where there's that hang to the right and hook to the left, Wendy usually bowls pretty good because she does get it out onto the lane, keeps the ball going in the right direction, and bowls well, and that's why she's leading the tournament.
That's a beautiful shot for Kim Terrell.
Kim's got the right lane down now. We've got to go back to the left lane and make an adjustment.
First game, Kim Terrell on the left lane. Here's how she was playing it, Carolyn.
Getting the ball a little bit to the right, and it's barely coming back.
Now here's this game and what's happening.
Starting it a little further in, getting it a little bit further right, hitting that out of bounds, ball's never recovering.
So she's opening up a little more?
Just a little bit more. That one's a little bit straighter. Look at that. Didn't get it as far right. Didn't get it as far right down the lane. Ball got into a nice roll. Great reaction.
All right, Wendy not only is bowling for a U.S. Open title here, but she is also looking to win her second Triple Crown. She's won the Invitational twice and the Queens twice and the U.S. Open once. If she wins here, she'll be only the second bowler, male or female, to win the Triple Crown twice.
What a wonderful feat. Back in 1986, she won $12,000 for winning the U.S. Open. What a change this is. Ooh. Got a little right. Looks like Wendy might have lost that one a little bit. See if we can see. Seems like she got that one a little far right. Maybe got out of it a little quick. One thing about Wendy is she really likes to use rosin. She sweats a little bit more on the side of it, got out of it a little quick. A little quick, just didn't get the hit, didn't get the right direction up the lane. Yes.
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. And a reaction from Wendy, who doesn't say much on TV. Look at this shot. Goes for it. She likes it. Slides it over. And you never see a reaction out of Wendy. That is fantastic.
You better love it. Seattle Seahawks look to keep their playoff hopes alive as they face division rivals the Denver Broncos tonight on Sunday Night Football. Coverage begins at 7:30 with NFL Primetime presented by Miller Lite. And then Mike Patrick, Paul McGuire, and Joe Theismann bring you this tough AFC West matchup. For more info, log on to ESPN.com. Wendy had to be loving that at all. How can that come right back at
you? I'm going to tell you, you make the 2-4-8-10, you get on the next lane, you regroup, you say, okay, get back into what you're doing. Does not look like a bad shot. Might have gotten a little bit further right than she had been. And that actually looks almost identical to the one Kim Terrell left on the right lane. Pins just left the deck.
Well, there was a host of pins around the 7 pin and didn't knock it down.
Bad break for Wendy.
Really, really bad break. She had just closed to within 6, and now she trails by 39 pins. Kim Terrell stepping up in the 6th, working on 2 strikes.
One thing Kim really worked on this week, her coach, Rod Ross, is a gold-level certified coach, really helped her stay in the moment, stay on top of things, and not second-guess herself, because sometimes she second-guesses herself and she gets lost.
It was kind of a
great shot. She's trying to take advantage of her moves, her execution, something she's worked very hard on.
Owens and Joyce Terrell actually behind Brian Markowitz and his lovely wife.
I saw Joyce Terrell during the break looking as nervous as ever and giving me the nod as in, yes, I am.
She made a quick phone call to have some fingernails put on after. I think she was biting them away here.
I think so.
Well, Kim, one of the weaknesses Kim said she had this week was the last day of match play. She wasn't aggressive enough on her first shot. And I think maybe we saw a little of that a little bit earlier. The last few shots, she's come back strong.
And basically, it was when the lanes were changing. When she'd go to another pair, she felt like they were changing. She double-guessed herself. There. Light shot, glow in the rack. Taking advantage of a good situation. That's what she needs to do. And let me tell you, with somebody like Wendy Macpherson, when you're bowling for a championship against Wendy, you have to put pressure on her. I mean, you don't get 19 titles for anything. Now, I did say she looked like she lost that last shot, actually the last two shots. She's inserting some tape. Wendy, another one of our big feel players. Like I said, she uses a lot of rosin on her hand, keeps her hand dry. The nerves set in, you shrink, you know, you should go down a little bit, need a little tape.
Here's a look at our leaders throughout the week, each round. Wendy on top there for the rounds. Leanne Barrette a couple, and Lisa Bishop, after the end of three rounds of qualifying, was our leader. Okay, Wendy, let's see what the tape did for you.
Gets the ball out onto the lane a little more.
Whoa! She made him dance.
I'd have to see that one again to see which pins actually all fell.
I bet they'll show it to you.
I'm sure they will. Hangs on to that one, gets it down the lane. Doesn't quite catch it the way she had been. Barely hits the head pin. Comes back. Knocks out the two, the four, the seven, and the five. I had a look at that. I was told it was the eight, not the five. I apologize.
It was just about half of the pins on the deck.
Good break, and a great shot after that.
Well, it's still a 39-pin match. Kim Terrell now up in the eighth frame, working on four strikes. And you can see the players, the athletes, slowing down a bit here. You want to get up there and bowl, but I have to say, I mean, they've never been in this position before. They've never bowled for this much money.
No, and I'm sure it sneaks into your mind every now and then. You just kind of got to put it in the right place. Another good shot. Now, she turned around and made a face. She got that one in, and that ball stayed online, and she got a great result. And it's okay. You know what? You make a mistake, you better make the right one. Kim gives a lot of credit to her collegiate experience. She got a great education. She bowled in college for San Jose State, and she is the collegiate spokesperson, and I can't think of anybody who would be a better spokesperson for collegiate bowling than Kim.
Well, this is a big shot for Kim Terrell. If she strikes here, she will not need to mark in the 10th frame. She'll just need some count.
This gets it a little right.
Shot.
My. Gets a break though, doesn't leave a slit. Leaves something spareable. Definitely missed right down the lane, hit that little bit of hang, but gets a break and not leaving a split. This is spareable. You know, she was on a five bagger, your adrenaline's going, you might get a little quick. She converts the spare, she's in shape.
Up that spare, and just a reminder to our viewers, coming up after this telecast, the NCAA Women's Soccer Championship. Stay tuned. If you're tuning in looking for that, it will be coming following the Women's Bowling U.S. Open Championship.
Well, basically, we're in a situation here now where Wendy has to strike.
Kim Terrell can strike out for 247. Wendy Macpherson can strike out for 231.
Basically forces Kim to mark in the 10th. Good shot by Wendy.
It is not over yet, folks. I have seen Wendy Macpherson step up for some very important things. One of them in the 10th frame at the Samsung Invitational, which basically locked up bowler of the decade for her. She struck when she needed it. She's a tough competitor under pressure. Don't expect anything but a shot in the pocket here from Wendy Macpherson.
doubled up on that one a little bit, but kept it online. Got a light hit. You are not bowler of the year 4 years in a row, bowler of the decade without being able to step up to the plate.
That's right, and you ought to know.
And
you're not runner-up either without doing that, but Wendy will need to pull one more out of her hat here to force Kim Terrell to get that mark in the 10th frame.
Wonder if she's thinking back to her first U.S. Open show many years ago.
As an 15, amateur.
As an amateur, looking back.
18 years old. Eight. Wow.
And the things she's done since. Gets it a little right. Leaves the two pin.
Doesn't trip the two. So with a spare here, Wendy Macpherson will shoot 220.
Makes the spare for the great game.
So Kim Terrell will need to step up and just get seven pins on this first shot to win her first major title and her first title in 2 years.
I'm nervous for her. It's been a lot of hard work to get to this moment. Rolls up. That's it.
That's enough. So nice gales don't always finish last. Kim Terrell, a three-time Robbie Award winner, grabs the largest paycheck in women's bowling history. Stay with us. The finals of the 2001 Women's U.S. Open Bowling Championship presented by Riverside Resort are being brought to you by the Women's International Bowling Congress, striving for 86 years to identify and fulfill the needs of women bowlers. By Travelodge Hotels, first with families, relax with Travelodge. And by Bowling's Mega Strike Jackpot, awarding thousands of dollars to lead bowlers. Is your bowling center participating? Kim Terrell, final score 236-220. Don Laughlin, Riverside Resort. Jack Moran of BPAA. So long from Riverside Resort. Coming up next, NCAA Women's Soccer Championship. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com.